That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Hello, Apollo 11, Houston, how did you go, over? Just opened up the LRL doors, Charlie. Roger, we got to come at all.
July 1969. Apollo 11 had carried two men to the surface of the moon. They had seen the Earth from the dusty landscape of an alien world. And now they were going home. It had been the greatest day in the history of human endeavor. But it could have been the last if foreign microbes from the barren moon invaded our planet. So for a while, Armstrong, Collins, and Aldrin would be quarantined in a special laboratory at Houston and taken there in a metal box, a coffin if the skeptics were right.
This is the greatest week in the history of the world since the creation, because as a result of what you've done, the world's never been closer together before. And we just thank you for that, and I only hope that as a result of what you've done, we can do our job a little better. We can reach for the stars just as you have reached so far from the stars.
The Russians followed American progress, eager to see what surprises the moon held. In 1966, they had placed Luna 9 on the surface, and later versions carried experiments for testing the bearing strength of the soil. The pictures sent back were a prelude to more ambitious projects, where soil samples would be brought to Earth in tiny capsules across a quarter of a million miles of space. When recovered, they provided important information about the moon from sites very different to places men explored in Apollo landing modules. To roam across the barren surface and send back television pictures along the way, Russian engineers designed a very remote-controlled vehicle for moving long distances and exploring the rocky valleys. Driven by electric motors and chain tracks, it would be operated from Earth, picking a route through the boulders and blocks. Finally, they got it right, and Lunokhod emerged as the first moon car. Driven down ramps deployed after landing, Lunokhod was built for rugged work on a rocky world. There would be no mechanic just around the bend, no hand to tighten loose bolts. Lunokhod was placed in a special chamber to simulate the airless moon, where oil would alternately freeze and boil, and lubricants act like glue. Luna 17 carried Lunokhod piggyback to the moon. From Earth went the command to start rolling. Safely down, the solar panel was opened, and mission control gave the order to drive off. In America, 4 months after the first landing, it was the turn of Apollo 12.
8, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engines running, commit liftoff. We have liftoff, 11:22 a.m. Eastern Standard Time.
That's a lovely liftoff. That's not bad at all. We have a problem here. I don't know what happened.
What happened was a lightning bolt in a storm-filled sky sent lights flashing and hearts pounding. It could have been a mission abort.
Apollo 12, Houston.
Hello, Houston. Yankee Clipper with Intrepid in tow has arrived on time.
The landing module was to prove it could make a pinpoint touchdown by flying past Surveyor 3, a robot fired to the moon 3.5 years before.
Coming down at 2 feet, you got plenty of gas. Plenty of gas, dude. Hang in there.
30 seconds.
18 feet, coming down at 2. Watch for the dust. He's got it made. Come on in there. 24 feet. Contact light.
Roger, copy contact.
Outstanding, man. Beautiful. He's got it.
Come back up the ladder,
not?
Man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me.
Holy shit, it's beautiful out here. It sure is. It's something else. I'll tell you, I think we're in a place that's a lot dustier than Neil's.
Surface is fine and powdery. I can...
Set to watch the moonwalk on TV, Controllers were frustrated when the solar rays destroyed the camera. But Surveyor got a visit from two moonwalkers who snipped off pieces to bring home. A package of instruments laid across the dusty surface would enable scientists on Earth to take the moon's pulse, look for signs of activity deep inside, or sample the bolts of radiation streaming from the sun. On Apollo 13, Commander Jim Lovell would head the third landing attempt to a place named Fra Mauro, while rookie pilot Fred Hayes rode along. It was Jack Swigert's role to stay in moon orbit.
10, 9, 8, ignition sequence has started. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We have commit and we have liftoff at 2:13. Senate has cleared the tower.
Caution and warning now. 180,000 miles from Earth and still headed for the moon, Apollo 13 was a crippled derelict in space. A sudden explosion deep inside the equipment section drained a spacecraft of electrical power. Living up to its number, 13 was a doomed flight unless the astronauts used the lunar module for power and oxygen. Serving as a lifeboat, it would have to keep them alive all the way around the moon and back to Earth, the only way home.
We'd like the nitrogen pressure on fuel cell 1. We need the oxygen pressure on fuel cell 2.
Clutching onto life, the astronauts built makeshift filter boxes for Lunar Module Aquarius to clean the air of carbon dioxide breathed out by the crew. Without these, Lovell, Hayes, and Swigert would be slowly poisoned to death. With temperatures near freezing, they held on. But of all the equipment on board, the most important were the little filter boxes adapted by the crew themselves. Time now to jettison the equipment section. What they saw sent shivers through the capsule.
You can jettison the service module when you're ready. No big rush, but anytime.
And there's one whole side of that spacecraft missing. Right by the high gate antenna, the whole panel is blown out, almost from the...
Now the Apollo capsule could be powered up. Lifeboat Aquarius had done its job, but only the command module could safely re-enter Earth's atmosphere.
Go ahead. Okay, you're go to start powering up the command module.
Right
now, we're
starting now.
Okay.
Houston, we'll punch off at
141
plus
30. Okay, Jack, we copy and we concur. Odyssey, Houston, we can give you a go if you'll put the logic on momentarily, please.
Okay, the next logic is on.
Okay, just copy that and you are go for fire alarm.
Real fine.
Been 2 minutes now from time of drogue deployment.
We're looking at the weather on TV and it looks just as advertised, real good.
Odyssey Houston, we show you on the main. It really looks great.
An extremely loud applause of Apollo 13.
Thank you. start. The exploration of space has been hazardous adventure. The voyage of Apollo 13 dramatized its risk. The men of Apollo 13, by their poise and skill, under the most intense kind of pressure, epitomized the character that accepts danger and surmounts it. Theirs is the spirit that built America.
The crew of Apollo 14 were to return to the moon and attempt a landing at the site first chosen for its jinxed predecessor. Modifications would ensure they succeeded.
Ignition sequence start. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Launch commit. We have liftoff. Apollo 14.
Coming down the ladder right now. It looks like you're about on the bottom step and on the surface. That's bad for an old man.
Okay, you're right. Hamlet's on the surface, and it's been a long way, but we're here.
And the,
Aged 47, Alan Shepard was the oldest man to reach the moon. With Ed Mitchell, he pulled a handcart up the rocky slopes of Cone Crater. They'd come to sample the boulders at the rim and needed frequent stops to cool down and get their breath. Back at the lunar module, Shepard tried a mid-iron shot with a makeshift golf club.
I have a little white pellet that's familiar to millions of Americans. Now drop it down. Unfortunately, the suit is so stiff I can't do this with two hands, but I'm going to try a little sand trap shot here.
That looked like a slice to me, Al.
There we go.
When Apollo 14 returned to lay the specter of 13, it saved the remainder of the moon program. Money was needed for other space projects. Popular opinion frowned on repeated flights to the moon. But there would be three more lunar trips made with improved spacecraft capable of staying 3 days and carrying electrical moon cars. It was July 71. Apollo 15 was ready.
9, 8, ignition sequence start. Engines on. 5, 4, 3. Launch commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff at 9:34 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time.
Lunar module Falcon flew a perilous descent to a valley flanked by hills, an impossible mission without the precision guidance of Apollo 12 nearly 2 years before.
Falcon is on the plane at Hadley.
Let's see, Houston, the centering on the picture is good now, and we're getting an excellent quality picture.
Very good.
Good. This is really a rock and rolling ride, isn't it? Never been on a ride like this before. Oh, boy. I'm glad they got this great suspension system on this thing.
In mission control, Ed Fendel operated the camera, while Scott and Irwin kicked boulders around for all the world to see.
That's just super. It's, you know, unreal.
But not everyone always watched where they were going.
No, dadgummit.
Having a few problems.
I can see the base of the front.
The serious business of moon science stretched Apollo to the limit. With longer spacewalks and better tools, they drilled for core samples, plugged the surface with thermometers, and for children on Earth, demonstrated a hammer and a feather hitting the ground simultaneously, proving that Galileo was right about airless space.
Hopefully, they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
How about that?
Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Dave, I'm reminded of a favorite biblical passage from Psalm. I look unto the hills from whence cometh my help. But of course, we get quite a bit from Houston, too.
Hey, Houston Falcon, how do you read on box?
Okay, loud and clear, Dave, and your go for liftoff.
Good liftoff. Automatic.
To the strains of a military band, it was up, up and away before Apollo jettisoned a satellite that would send information from space long after the crew returned.
Tally-ho. And Houston 15, as we leave and look back, why, I guess we still have the impression the moon is mostly gray. However, when you're up, son, it does definitely take on a chocolate brown color.
Remember, there's... Around the moon, Apollo gathered scientific data from instruments in the equipment section. Halfway back to Earth, astronaut Warden left the craft to retrieve the cassettes carrying this vital data.
We perfectly clear.
We copy your report, Al. Thank you.
Plunging through the atmosphere at more than 25,000 miles an hour, 15's capsule, slowed by friction, returned with a treasure store of rocks and dust collected from nearly 20 hours on three moonwalks. But all was nearly lost when a parachute line snapped due to corrosive fuel, which was jettisoned from the descending capsule. Falling faster than planned, the astronauts received a nasty jolt. Had another chute failed, it could have cost their lives. The mission began the most productive stage of Apollo exploration, just when government backing reached an all-time low. Yet the samples unfurled a dramatic story of moon history, long before the earliest records on Earth.
Launch is running. Launch commit and liftoff.
We have a launch commit and we have a liftoff. We've cleared the tower.
April 72, and Apollo 16 blasts into space for a rendezvous with the moon 3 days later. On board, John Young chalked up his fourth flight into space.
Houston, Fleet 16 has arrived.
Roger 16, copy loud and clear.
Repeat again, we are go for landing.
Looks like we're going to be able to make it, John. There's not too many blocks up there.
Roger. Okay, there we go, John. It's on the ground, Houston. Outstanding. There you go. Let's pick this baby up and turn it around. Okay. Makes you proud to be an American, Tony.
Unpacking the equipment, Young and Duke prepared for a drive on the lunar surface. First, a Grand Prix with a difference. Even the most meticulous plans can be disrupted within seconds by a clumsy moonwalker. John Young plowed up a cable carefully laid down to carry information from an intricate heat flow experiment.
With the RTG package, I...
Charlie, what?
Something happened here.
What happened?
I don't know. There's a line that pulled loose.
Oh.
What line is it?
That's the heat flow. You pulled it off.
I don't know how that happened.
So we understand that the cable came off of the connector and we've got just a free end of the cable, is that right?
That's right. Okay, the LSM is on the surface. I'm going to deploy a separate station.
Okay.
We're stopped.
Tony, you don't know how much fun this has been.
Why, Houston, the beauty of this place is just absolutely incredible. Okay, I'm gonna park the rover, Houston. I think we got everything out of it there is to get, okay?
Okay, it sounds good. We think so, too.
Right. And we're doing just like old 97, really moving down the track.
Roger.
This view is just beautiful.
December 1972. and the final Apollo moon flight presented a spectacle for space watchers along the Florida coastline. It was to be the best of them all, a fitting departure for a long last look.
Expect engine ignition at 8.9 seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, ignition sequence started. All engines are started. We have ignition. 2, 1, 0. We have a liftoff. We have a liftoff and it's lighting up the area. It's just like daylight here.
As we pitch back into LOI attitude, lo and behold, from over the top of the lamp came the Earth. Put the whole thing in one big package. Hey, I just saw a flash on the lunar surface.
Oh, yeah?
It was just right out there north of Grimaldi.
40 feet, going down at 3. Stand by for touchdown.
Stand by.
Feels good. 20 feet. Going down at 2. 10 feet. Contact. Okay, Houston, the Challenger has landed.
Moving quickly to clear the field for a geology trip, Cernan and Schmidt drilled holes for a heat flow experiment designed to take the moon's temperature. But getting things in is sometimes easier than getting them out, and once in a while you just had to take whatever help was offered.
I'm gonna get this thing out now that I got it.
Boys, you know, that's what you call getting down into your work.
The astronauts gave the roving car a workout that battered wheels and dust guards beyond design limits. Not surprisingly, a wheel guard broke, showering the crew with dust. That meant a fix-it job on the spot, a very long way from the nearest service station. Like good tourists, they used old maps held fast by a telescope clamp and went on their way. Rolling boulders down a dusty slope educated scientists in the binding properties of moon soil. The astronauts did it for fun.
Well, I know. I gotta look around a little more. It sure is not Trident. It's, you're pretty agile there, Twinkle Toes. You bet your life I am.
Hey!
Wait a minute.
What?
Where are the reflections? I've been through once.
There is orange soil.
Well, don't move it till I see it.
Orange?
I've got to dig a trench, Houston.
Copy that. I guess we better work
fast. It really is. Fantastic, sports fans.
Cavorting across the surface, two very happy astronauts were having a ball.
Rolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
No, May. May. May is the month.
May, that's right.
May is the year of the month.
When, much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes. We shall return with peace and in hope for all mankind. Godspeed the crew of Apollo 17.
From Mission Control, the cheering echoed throughout NASA. In 3.5 spectacular years, 6 missions had carried 18 men and returned them safely, with 835 pounds of moon rock and new perspectives on the history of the solar system. The accomplishments had been enormous, and scientists would study the trophies for a decade. Started by John Kennedy in 1961, the race to the moon had not been won for Americans alone, but for all mankind. Yet even as the consoles were being switched off, a new age was about to dawn. Apollo moon flights ended, French rocket engineers made a commitment to build a European launcher. It was called Ariane. From inside a clamshell fairing jettisoned in space, satellites would be placed around Earth to serve a growing number of paying customers, looking to the benefits of a productive space program. Just what those benefits were would become apparent in the decade of the 70s. Ariane was developed to put payloads high above Earth where they would keep pace with the spinning surface and provide a continuous 24-hour service. The Japanese took a similar initiative, and NASDA, the National Space Development Agency, was set up to help boost Japan's expanding industries. The first Japanese launcher had a helping hand from American industry. Called the N-Series, it would carry satellites into orbit for communication and weather forecasting, and as a bow to their peaceful intent, each spacecraft would be named after a flower.
Go.
The astonishing growth in satellite application during the 1970s gave birth to a revolution in communications that swept the world, bringing remote regions into contact with each other for the first time.
Hello.
Nag-iba na ba? Naigin naman yata niya. Nakasahan ko mabuti naman ang kalagayan ng mga
nalulang. All manner of information would be carried on electromagnetic waves coursing through space to a satellite 22,000 miles above Earth. Hanging in orbit a tenth of the way to the moon, they link machines with messages from teleprinters and newspaper terminals, sending computer data halfway around the world and all the way back again. Eager to promote the new capacity for linking distant continents, presidents, prime ministers, and broadcasters spoke to each other through the TV satellites, gathering an audience of millions where once they spoke to a few. The phenomenal expansion of human chatter was spurred further by the Intelsat organization, a gathering of more than 100 countries which would collectively pay for advanced communications. First launched in 1980, a series of Intelsat 5 satellites will carry telephone traffic for much of the decade until replaced by even more advanced models by the 1990s. Each Intelsat 5 can carry more than 12,000 simultaneous telephone conversations or beam to the ground several television programs, live or on video. When men first set foot on the moon in 1969, each Intelsat would carry only 1,500 telephone calls, and the first global service had only just begun. Now, Intelsat 6 satellites are planned, each carrying more than 32,000 calls. By the early 1990s, about 10 will be in space to handle the ever-increasing demand for more capacity. Demand has already cut the costs of a telephone call to one-tenth the price it would be without satellites. For the 1980s, that capacity is provided by the Intelsat 5 family and made available to 108 countries on Earth for a fraction of the cost of a ground-based network. Launched by an Atlas rocket, Intelsat 5 unfolds in space to serve people in wealthy and not-so-wealthy countries throughout the developing world. And where nations plan effectively to reap the benefits of technology, communication is the key. But satellites that bring people closer through routine access to a telephone also help reach children in remote and half-forgotten places where education is a struggle. Television signals sent through space bring direct contact between schools and centers of learning, helping teachers wherever they may be. Better use of water resources and farmland, more efficient management of poor soils and agricultural development throughout the Third World hinges on the ability to teach precious skills. Crop production depends on information being distributed and then put to good use, through whatever means it can. Indonesia set the trend and launched its first satellite on an American rocket in 1976, linking 5,000 separate island communities. In this way, people everywhere talk through machines that break the barriers of language. Children are the first to use these new tools for a better way of understanding the world. On a planet stretched by diminishing resources, insufficient food for a quarter of the world's population, and a need to develop more farmland, mismanagement of the Earth has reached epidemic proportions. Millions of children starve to death each year because the world has no place for poverty. The abuse of the planet goes on, and soon it might be too late. As caretaker of a fragile planet, Landsat patrols the Earth from a polar orbit in space, generating pictures to spot pollution, effluent, and the foul products of industrial societies. A nodding mirror casts a reflective eye and sends to the ground images that track man's destruction of the Earth. With information like this, the countdown to extinction can be reversed. If caught in time, the planet will survive, and the growth of human populations become a sign of progress. Today, it is a symbol of failure, and will only improve through the better use of technology working with nature and not against it. To make technology work in the best interests of the planet, images sent from space designate specific zones under threat from disease or poor land management. Infrared pictures pick out important defects in crop health and show changes to land and water. Matched with aerial pictures of the ground, digital images from space give operators the key to where fertilizers are needed in the fields. Landsat is a global resource in itself, and infrared pictures of a lakeside town pick out industrial pollution of water and atmosphere, pinpointing the guilty source. Pollution of the atmosphere and industrial chemicals released into the air are easily traced from space, helping lawmakers to prohibit factory owners from ignoring environmental rules and shore-based industries from killing the living streams. Designed to see the Earth as a complex, living organism, Landsat is a powerful protector of the ecosphere. When man turns his back on the environment and fails to live in harmony with nature, the consequences are far-reaching. But the multi-layered images from bigger and better Landsats are building a defense against abuse. Floods that wash away farmland and insects that destroy crops are plagues that Landsat is designed to monitor. And when drought strikes or a desert lays waste the sparse food and water resources used by nomadic tribes, pictures from an Earth-scanning satellite locate new places to settle. Most new minerals are first seen in satellite pictures that give precise information on the size of the field and help engineers balance industrial and environmental needs with those of the community. The Earth's most precious resource is water, but all too frequently dries up, cutting food production and creating famine. The fight for survival has a new weapon with the caretaker satellite working for everyone, everywhere. From a European weather satellite far out in space comes information vital for storm warnings that regularly save many lives in tropical zones where natural disasters are commonplace. One of the oldest sciences on Earth, meteorology is limited without technology. Now, tracking stations receive pictures of an entire hemisphere, showing weather patterns across millions of square miles. Indexed and distributed around the globe, often by the satellites themselves, information on hurricanes, typhoons, rain, and snowfall helps people defend their lives and property. The view from space tells weathermen temperatures at the top and the bottom of the atmosphere, of cloud patterns and areas of increasing pressure. And new instruments flying in the latest spacecraft record moisture levels and pick out rain showers moving across the globe. Like their Landsat counterparts, weather satellites patrol the planet, measuring details about the atmosphere and building a resource vital for better management of Earth and all its living things. It is an indispensable tool in the fight for survival. Thank you. Earth and space meet at the atmosphere's edge, and just above the planet's thin blue veil, observatories scan the universe. From the ground, Earth's atmosphere obscures the view that airless space provides, and massive telescopes must compensate for this distortion to study and understand the powerful forces that sustain life. The sun is a vital link in our weather chain, and careful observation of solar flares the size of Earth helps us better understand the planet itself. By understanding the solar system, the Earth's balance of natural and artificial resources can be more meaningfully interpreted, allowing man to know where nature puts a limit on human intervention. The exploration of the solar system is an essential part of husbanding our planet in a more intelligent way. Scientists believe the solar system formed from gas and dust in a galaxy of 100 billion stars. Soon, a hot core at the center gave birth to a protostar, the Sun. Planets formed from rocks and boulders left over at the Sun's birth, now a star in its own right, shining with life-giving energy. The primitive planets were bombarded with debris from the solar system, gouging out basins and huge craters on the surface. Closest to the Sun, Mercury was to be visited from a spacecraft called Mariner 10, launched in 1973 for a flyby with a barren planet. But Venus, second out from the Sun, was to get an even closer inspection from two spacecraft, one American, the other Russian. In an almost parallel race to gather the most information, the two countries prepared probes to penetrate the atmosphere and land on the surface of this alien and inhospitable planet. Special care was needed to make the heat shields in which the probes could survive in an atmosphere where ground temperatures are more than 800 degrees Fahrenheit and pressures are 90 times that at the surface of the Earth. Insulated from the heat, scientific instruments would monitor conditions on Venus and record the hostile environment where no life could exist. Not built to survive on the surface, but the Russian lander was designed to operate for several hours and send back pictures, showing for the first time what cloud-shrouded Venus was really like. Lowered by parachutes, the capsules made an extraordinary journey through sulfur lakes and dense carbon dioxide clouds. Free falling to a surface so hot that lead would run in rivers of fire, the capsule survived. What Russia's lander saw was an astonishing display of heat-cracked rock and volcanic boulders, unlike anything elsewhere in the solar system, an inferno of gas and fumes. And all the time, another American spacecraft mapped the swirling clouds above and charted the weather patterns that tore around a planet more than 50 times faster than Venus rotated on its axis. It was an atmosphere quite different to Earth's jeweled oasis. Water and a comfortable atmosphere were not the characteristics found on other planets. But Mars held hope that here robots from Earth might find primitive living things. It's a dim hope that living organisms might yet appear on this strange world and grow to resemble life on Earth 3 billion years ago. But they may have appeared already and be in so simple a form that we cannot even understand where they are or what they look like. The dream of an Earth-like world is gone. Only barren deserts and rocky ravines break the monotony of a cratered surface. The most ambitious robot lander ever sent to the planets was NASA's Viking spacecraft. Its very special purpose, to find out if life had evolved on Mars. Viking was protected by a shell designed to split apart and set the lander free. It would be launched by a mighty Titan rocket built from elements of a ballistic missile of the type that once carried 12 Gemini capsules into space. Carried by a spacecraft that stayed in orbit around Mars, the Viking lander's touchdown spot was decided by a careful study of photographs sent back to Earth. There were many dangers at the surface, and a million rocks to break a robot's leg. A very large library of photographs provided by this and earlier flights helped build the references from which a suitable landing place could be chosen. Assembled on a globe, they gave incredible detail to this picture pattern of Mars and served to aid scientists plan new tasks for Viking. When at last a suitable spot was found, the Viking prepared to land, separating from the orbiter, but still inside its shell. As the capsule drifted toward Mars, the shell divided. Slowed by friction with the atmosphere and parachutes deployed on the way down, rocket motors took over and lowered the lander to the surface. Desolation faced the cameras with no obvious sign of life. But an arm with a scoop would dig the dust and pick small pebbles for analysis in an experiment designed to see if tiny living things were there after all. Shaken through a funnel and taken by conveyor belt to chambers inside Viking. What scientists saw resembled life seen in some soils on Earth, but they could find no physical sign. If life was there, the bugs were consuming their own bodies. Was it a germ totally alien to machines from Earth? Nobody knows, but there is nothing like it anywhere on this planet. Beyond Mars, a rocky belt of asteroids and boulders separates the four inner planets from huge giants beyond, worlds 1,000 times the size of Earth. To probe these distant regions of the solar system, NASA launched Pioneer and Voyager spacecraft to chart the colder corridors of interplanetary space and photograph the colored bands of Jupiter. Occasionally, a moon or two drifts by. There are numerous moons around this enormous ball of gas, each locked to the gravity of the solar system's biggest planet. A psychedelic montage of sounds from Earth was carried on a disc attached to Voyager. Messages to unidentified aliens encountered on the way. Then it's Callisto's turn, peppered with a million tiny craters and speckles of shining frost. Giant Jupiter is the star attraction. The great red spot, so large, three worlds the size of Earth could float inside. Almost twice as far from the Sun, Saturn's beauty dominates Jupiter's size, a gaseous world ringed with enigmatic bands and more than 20 escorting moons. Clustered particles form the main rings, but Voyager's camera sees a fingerspread of moving bands, tiny particles suspended just above the main rings by magnetic forces from the center of the planet, defying the main streams to stand apart from the crowd. Instruments scan the rings, studying the myriad particles that orbit Saturn in a remorseless convoy of ice chips. A billion miles past Saturn, Voyager takes a look at Uranus, a planet tilted on its side and circled by a few thin rings. And sometime in 1989, if it survives, Voyager flies past Neptune and moves on to one of its moons. Pioneer and Voyager are leaving the solar system to reach other stars a million years from now. They carry messages from planet Earth to tell the citizens of alien worlds where they came from all those millions of years ago. By then, the Earth will be a frozen remnant in a dead solar system. Is there anybody out there to know? Or even care?